peace on earth, goodwill to men. This is past week, I found an article that was written, and I'll just share the words. It's right on for this morning. How can there be joy to the world when there is so much sorrow on earth? How can there be thoughts of sleigh bells jingling, chestnuts roasting on an open fire, Jack Frost nipping at our noses when war rages in Israel and Ukraine, and deep hatred of God's chosen people continues seething in our nation's street? Henry Wadsworth Longfellow, one of America's greatest poets, thought the same exactly 160 years ago. It was on Christmas Day, 1863, this Civil War, of course, was raging, a ravaging storm, ripping a gashing hole in the fabric of the Republic, while at the same time, Longfellow had suffered from personal tragedies. His wife of 18 years, whose name was Fanny, and the mother of his six children had died 2 years earlier in a fiery accident in their home after her dress caught fire from a lit candle. Longfellow's son, Charlie, was critically injured then after the Civil War began, fighting for the Union Army near Washington, D.C. And so on that day, the sound of the church bells heralding Christmas seemed to mock the very thought of peace on earth. And yet through his personal grief and the torment of a war that would claim nearly 1 million lives, Longfellow penned his famous poem that has become a Christmas carol for the ages, "I Heard the Bells on Christmas Day." Their old familiar carols play, and wild and sweet the words repeat of peace on earth, goodwill to men. He wrote those words while he heard the bomb and the cannon blasts. And of course, the song goes on in this way: "Then from each black accursed mouth, the cannon thundered in the south. And with the sound, the carols drowned of peace on earth, goodwill to men. There is no peace on earth," I said, "for hate is strong and mocks the song of peace on earth, goodwill to men." And then pealed the bells more loud and deep: "God is not dead, nor doth he sleep. The wrong shall fail, the right prevail, with peace on earth, goodwill to men." Peace on earth, goodwill to men. Jesus Christ, the one who is our peace. If you have your Bibles in hand this morning, I invite you to turn with me to the Gospel of John, chapter 14. Jesus, our peace, is the theme this morning. John 14, 25, 26, and 27. John 14. Jesus said, "These things I have spoken to you while I am still with you. But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid." And you may recall those very words were words that Jesus said earlier in this time, that very evening with his disciples, where he told them that he was going away and that they could not come. And he starts out this 14th chapter with those very words: "Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you." Jesus was there that final night in the upper room with his 11 remaining disciples. They were men who had, of course, been chosen by the Lord himself. They'd left their families. They'd left the jobs or livelihoods to follow Jesus. And now Jesus was telling them he was leaving them and they couldn't come. Of course, we might understand that the questions were arising and the doubts and the fears would have flooded their minds, and perhaps just the very question, but why, Lord, why after all this time? Jesus said, I'm leaving. I'm going to prepare a place for you, but I'm coming back. I'm going away, but the Helper is going to come. My peace I give to you. You know, when Jesus appeared after the resurrection then, if you look there at John chapter 20, John 20 verse 19, Jesus appears to them. John 20:19, John tells us here, records for us that on the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, peace be with you. And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side, and then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. And Jesus said to them again, peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you. Moving down to verse 26. 8 days later, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. And although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them, and he said, peace be with you. Peace be with you. By his resurrection, Jesus had come to bestow peace. He was the peace of which he was speaking. A new kind of peace, of course, a peace that doesn't come through the cessation of warfare or violence, but rather through the marvelous deliverance of Christ's shed blood at the cross of Calvary. It's the very same peace that Jesus gives to every pardoned sinner today. Every pardoned sinner who comes to by faith to Jesus. Peace, shalom, is the Hebrew term. And shalom takes on a whole new meaning for we who have found and received his peace. You know, peace is a comforting thought, isn't it? Peace. It's a comforting thought, especially in a world such as ours, racked by war and hatred and conflict and unrest. And we think in the global sense of that idea, we think how sweet it would be to live in a world where peace reigns. But perhaps the thought of peace hits even more closely to our homes when we realize that even within our own families at times there are fractured relationships and hurt and brokenness in our personal lives, or perhaps even in turmoil, as was Longfellow, the poet. I heard the bells on Christmas Day, their old familiar carols play, and wild and sweet the song repeats of peace on earth, goodwill to men. So perhaps we could ask the question, how do Jesus' words apply? I mean, that's great, Pastor Steve, you know, to talk about all these things, you know, even read the stories, you know, as were read today. Myron read the complete story. We call it the Christmas story, if you will, from Luke's gospel. We know that. And perhaps you're here today and you think, well, that's just a story. You know, it's nice. We see it here in the Bible, but, you know, it's just a story. It's just a story. How does that apply to me? How does it seem to apply to me here today, 20 centuries after the fact, you know? How does Jesus' promise of peace affect us and apply to you, to me today? Well, I'm going to suggest this morning that to answer that question, first we must address three significant basic questions. And that'll be the framework as we think about this today. The first question is perhaps the most obvious question of all. That is the question, what is peace? What is peace? Question number one. Well, peace, I've inferred it already today, is the word taken from the Hebrew word, which is the word shalom. And so when we read in our English translations, peace, Jesus, of course, was speaking in the common vernacular of the Jews, the Israelites, and they spoke the language of Hebrew, the Hebrew language, and their word would have been shalom. Now, to that effect, Pastor Alistair Begg makes this remark. He says, this peace of which Jesus was speaking here, this peace is not simply the absence of something. the absence of turmoil or conflict. Rather, it is the presence of everything that is necessary for the well-being of the individual. And then he refers to what's called the Aaronic blessing, which is found in Numbers, the book of Numbers, chapter 6, which is this: the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace, his shalom. Shalom. And so Alistair Begg concludes with this. He says, that peace cannot be discovered absent the light of God's countenance and the blessing of his grace and his goodness. You know, realize that the song of the angels on that holy night that Jesus was born over the shepherds who were out in the hillside outside of Bethlehem, you know, glory to God in the highest and on earth, peace among men on whom his favor rests. It's that very same thing. It's the same peace of which Jesus is speaking here in chapter 14, verse 27. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you, not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. The peace that Jesus promised is the very same peace that was proclaimed by the angels the night Jesus was born to the shepherds. That peace, the peace of Christ, you see, as Jesus even said, is an otherworldly peace. In other words, it's a peace that cannot be found despite the supposed interests and efforts of the diplomats and the people that are working to bring about a diplomacy, if you will. It cannot be brought about through diplomacy or by world powers getting around speaking across a large conference meeting table of some sort, and it cannot be achieved or found by the destruction of our enemy, because those things at best are simply a temporary solution at most. Indeed, the peace that Jesus promised cannot be realized or experienced any other way but by God's glorious countenance shining down upon us, as we read there with the Aaronic blessing, and the blessing of God's grace and his goodness being showered down upon us, because therein is true and lasting peace. And so, what is peace? Question number one. Peace is the outcome, the expression of an experiential realization of a restored relationship with God. First and foremost, what is peace? It's otherworldly. It's not, even as many of us might be familiar with, what is commonly known as a peace position. Oftentimes one of the pillars of the Anabaptist community and their viewpoints and so forth. It's more than that. For unfortunately, that the mistaken foundation of the peace position, as perhaps we know, is that it's based upon how we interact with people. And yes, we are, as far as it concerns us, to live at peace with all men. We understand that. Romans 12, certainly. Yes. But unfortunately, there's, without the foundation of the cross, may I direct you to the cross here? What holds the cross member in place? What holds the cross member in place? The vertical. That cross member isn't suspending itself in midair. Here's the point. As long as we only seek this peace, that peace with humankind, which is mankind seeking after diplomacy and that kind of a peaceful coexistence, it falls to the ground because there's nothing holding it up. The vertical, this peace with you and the Creator, must first be there in the ground. Nobody puts up a post in the ground without anchoring it down. And Jesus is the rock upon which our faith is anchored. Amen? He is our peace. So what is peace? Peace is the experiential reflection of a relationship that has been restored with our Creator and God. The second question that must be asked is then this. So why is it needed? Why is it needed? And to that, let me just reference one verse, and it comes from Romans 5 and verse 1. Therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Why is peace needed? Well, we need peace. We need God's peace. We need that peace because without it, there is no hope in this life. And ever since the fall, which goes back to the Garden of Eden, where Adam and Eve rejected God's will and disobeyed him, and subsequent to that, of course, Cain killed his brother Abel, the awful consequences of sin have racked, plagued, and destroyed mankind. We see that through warfare, death, pain, suffering, and the curse of sin being unleashed upon us. And that is what Paul the Apostle was driving at when in his letter to the church in Ephesus, in Ephesians chapter 2, he says this to the believers there, and you, believers now in Christ, you were dead in your trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, just like the rest of mankind. Why is peace needed? Because without it, we don't have any hope. That's why. You realize that it's been estimated that since the Reformation in the early 1500s, the 16th century, over 8,000 peace treaties have been signed. With the intention of what? Bringing about a peace that would resolve and cure the conflict. How many of those are actually lasting today? Goose egg. Nada. Zero. 8,000 such efforts. You see, the thing is, any effort of mankind, of human beings, mankind, no matter how supposedly noble on their face they might be to bring about a peace on earth, is actually a futile and hopeless pursuit. Because there's no true and lasting peace on earth that we could ever realize or experience, despite the boasting of the diplomats and the people in the government in the United States or anywhere else around the world, world leaders, or even people that are so-called prophets, that one day peace is going to come. And we know from Paul's one letter to the Thessalonian believers that they're going to claim peace and safety, but then the end will come. Because it's not to happen. There's only one in whom peace can be found. So why is peace needed? We need real peace because without the peace of God, mankind is hopelessly lost and outside. What Paul, again, referring back once one final time to his letter to the Ephesians, Paul the Apostle refers to as being outside the commonwealth of Israel, the blessing of God, the goodness of God, and the favor of God. They're picking up in Ephesians 2 in verse 4, or excuse me, down in verse 12, rather, Ephesians 2, 12. Remember that at one time you... Again, he's writing to the church in Ephesus. Remember, at one time, you, Gentiles, predominantly at that time, were separated from Christ, alienated from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. Why? Because they were outside the boundary of God's covenants and promises to his people Israel at that time. But now, in Christ Jesus, he says, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made us both one and has broken down in his flesh the dividing wall of hostility by abolishing the law of commandments expressed in ordinances, so that he might create in himself one new man in the place of two, Jew and Gentile, so making peace. It might reconcile us both to God in one body through the cross, thereby killing the hostility. And he came and he preached peace to you who are far off and peace to those who were near. For through him, we both have access in one spirit to the Father. And so then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are now fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God. And so Jesus said, the Helper is going to come, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, and he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Why do we need peace? Because without that, we are hopelessly lost and without any hope of salvation in heaven and eternal life without Jesus Christ. And so where is God's peace to be found? It's found in Christ, in him alone, period. And for that, we could look back into the Old Testament two different places. One is Isaiah chapter 9, verses 6 and 7. For unto us a child is born, Isaiah writes, unto us a son is given, and he will be called, his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and of peace, there will be no end. It was the verse, the prophetic text that was referred to even by the angels to the shepherds, speaking of the one, the child has been born, the son has come, the hope of the world. Micah is another place we could look to, the prophet Micah chapter 5, another well-known prophetic text speaking about the coming of the Messiah, the Christ child, Micah 5:2. But you, O Bethlehem Ephrathah, who are too little to be among the clans of Judah, from you shall come forth for me one who is to be ruler in Israel, whose coming forth is from of old, from ancient days. Therefore he shall give them up until the time when she who is in labor has given birth. And then the rest of his brothers shall return to the people of Israel. And he shall stand and shepherd his flock in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God, and they shall dwell secure, for now he shall be great to the ends of the earth, and he shall be their peace. One other reference to the peace of Christ that's actually found in Acts chapter 10, verse 36. This is when Peter had gone to the home of Cornelius at the summons of God to declare to them the gospel message. Acts 10:36, as for the word that he sent to Israel, this is Peter now, as for the word that he sent to Israel, preaching good news of peace through Jesus Christ, he is Lord of all. You yourselves know what happened throughout all Judea. And there in that moment, in that time, that day there at Cornelius' house, God spoke through the man Peter, the apostle, to bring the good news to the Gentiles for the very first time. The key, if you will, to unlock the hope of Christ there. You know the Christmas hymn, O Little Town of Bethlehem, how still we see thee lie. Above thy deep and dreamless sleep, the silent stars go by. Yet in thy dark streets shineth the everlasting light. The hopes and fears of all the years are met in thee tonight. For Christ is born of Mary and gathered all above. While mortals sleep, the angels keep their watch of wondering love. O morning stars, together proclaim thy holy birth, and praises sing to God the King, and peace to men on earth. So where is peace to be found? God's peace. You know, there is a true and lasting, unconquerable peace that is only to be found and only to be known by those who have put their faith and their trust in Almighty God and his Son, Jesus Christ. He is our peace. He is, as Isaiah prophesied, our Prince of Peace. He is, as Micah said, he is our peace, right? Paul picked up that same thing. And here in John again, chapter 14, this key text that we've started from here this morning, this is what the very thing that Jesus was telling to the disciples that night, that final night in the upper room before he was betrayed and eventually crucified. Or a few days before then, he was resurrected and ascended into glory. That's what Jesus was saying. And he's saying that through his word to you and to me today. You see, the peace that Jesus promises is not of this world. Now, I referred to that and made that comment just a few minutes ago, but listen to what Jesus says here again. It's found in the same discourse in John, this time John 16:33, where Jesus says to them, he says, I have said these things to you so that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but take heart, for I have overcome the world. The Helper's coming, he said. The Helper. Jesus promised peace that's not of this world. You see, the peace that Jesus gives isn't negotiated among the diplomats of the world, the ambassadors of the world. The peace that Jesus gives is an everlasting peace. It's the peace that's of God that's abiding within us, the peace that showers his goodness and his favor and his love upon all we who have confessed the name of Jesus Christ and believed upon his name, believed in our hearts, because we need to turn to the Lord. We need to turn to the Savior. We need to find that peace. That peace is not to be found any other place. The peace of Jesus does not arise within your heart, doesn't come from your own mind or thoughts or your ingenuity or your best laid plans and hopes and dreams of something better. Why? Because by nature, we're all sinners. We're hopelessly lost without the work of God in and through Christ. The peace which Jesus gives is actually heaven sent. It comes from beyond mankind. It comes from beyond us, from outside us. It's beyond our ability as human beings both to obtain and to retain, to keep the peace of God, the peace of Christ that sustains us and endures. It's as Jesus said, that it is not as the world gives. His peace is not just an emotional experience that's temporary, it's fleeting, it's here for a moment and gone as soon as some hard thing comes into your life. No, the peace of Christ is a person, you see. It's the person of Jesus. It's not an emotion. It's not a feeling. It's not, some idle thought or dream or wish or what have you, a fanciful notion. It's not of this world. The Holy Spirit is the other helper, as Jesus said. He is actually the peace of Christ that resides in us. Jesus said here, I'm going to send the helper. I'm going away, but I'm sending you the helper. And the language there that we don't see here to get really clearly in our English text, when he uses that term, that comes from a Greek word that means a helper of another of the same kind, and another one of the same kind, the other helper. It's the Holy Spirit who is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Christ in you, the hope of glory. In fact, he says much the same when he says here in John 15 in verse 26, but when the helper comes, speaking of the Holy Spirit, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth, who proceeds from the Father, he will bear witness about you, about me. So Jesus is speaking about the Holy Spirit, and God's peace, the peace of Christ, is found by those who stop striving after things in this world, who, in order to do what? In order to somehow lay hold of or to secure for ourselves a lasting peace, somehow to get beyond it. Some people feel like if I just get over this hump, then I'll have peace. If I just do all this one thing, maybe I just need to move away and live out in the middle of nowhere by myself, and then I'll have peace. You know the monastic movement, really, which goes back to the Middle Ages and beyond, was in part and parcel this idea that because these men that became monks, basically believed that if they were to just withdraw from the sinful world and the things that came from that sinful world and the effects of temptation in their hearts and lives, if they just moved away and got quiet before God and gave up and lived lives of poverty, it was self-imposed as asceticism, that kind of a lifestyle, that somehow then they would find peace with God. Then they could have peace with God, but only to find that even in the monastery, all alone, the sinful nature still rears its ugly head. And you're just alone then. without the influence perhaps of other things in the world necessarily, but the fact of the matter is the problem doesn't lie out there. The problem lies in here, and only Jesus can restore that. And that is why this promise of the Holy Spirit coming to reside in us, having been born again, is of the ultimate importance and essential nature of the Christian life. The peace of Christ is experienced by those who surrender their lives, dying to themselves, by coming under the lordship of Jesus Christ when you're saved. We're born again, the Holy Spirit, the helper, as Jesus said, the helper of the same kind as Jesus. Now, Jesus is not just walking among us. He's residing within us by his Holy Spirit. He is our peace. And one last thing. God's everlasting peace, the peace of which Jesus promised here, spoke of, stands guard over us. I will peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Perhaps you remember this one verse. It comes from Paul's letter to the church in Philippi. It's Philippians 4:7. Actually, I'm going to pick up verse 6. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. God's everlasting peace isn't a fleeting thing. The promise of God's everlasting peace is the very promise that the Apostle Paul wrote of which certainly he himself knew. That indwelling sense of the peace of God, the Holy Spirit, which all who follow Christ and know and experience, and to know that requires something. It's sort of a conditional thing. As we read those verses rightly, he says we have to lay our burdens down. We have to come to the Lord and acknowledge these thoughts and fears and anxious concerns or what have you, what they are, and lay them down. And then in exchange for that, the promise is this, and the peace of God, right? The peace of God which surpasses all understanding, all your, just the comprehension that you would have as a person, the peace of God will actually stand guard over your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. But it requires us to lay down the anxious thought, to surrender. And again, this takes us back to the foot of the cross. And at that point, at that place, and that's why, friends, the gospel message that we proclaim must begin at the cross. Without the cross is not the gospel, because without the cross, there's not a Savior. There's no forgiveness. There's no propitiatory sacrifice that Jesus gave. There's no atonement for your sin. It's just another fanciful story. And believe you me, we who know the Savior understand this is not just a fanciful story. This is not a fable. It's not just, well, that's nice for y'all, you know, to think about or believe upon. But, you know, we know science knows this. The world thinks that, whatever. No. Those things, the world will never figure this stuff out, because without the knowledge that only God gives through his Spirit indwelling us and the Holy Spirit, speaking through the Word of God, the Scriptures, without that, all we have is our own notions as human beings. So again, in review, what is peace? Shalom. It's peace with God. It's peace that experientially expresses a restored relationship with the Creator first and foremost. Why is it needed? Because without that, you'll never know real peace. Without the peace of God, mankind is hopelessly lost and outside, as Paul wrote, outside the commonwealth of the boundary of God's blessing, goodness, and favor. So the last question is where it lands. Where is that all to be found? It's only one place, the Christ child, Jesus Christ. And that is why Christmas time for the believer is of the utmost significance and beauty. Because Christmas is more than just a time for snowmen and Santa Claus and so forth and so on, as, you know, I guess fanciful as those things can be. Christmas time is again the annual reminder that God did what only God could do. And that God came near. He came to earth to be born as a man, born under the law, to redeem those who are under the law, so that he could restore us to the Lord Jesus, to the Lord God, our Father, through Christ and his sacrifice. That is the heart of the Christmas story. And my friends, it is my hope and prayer today. God knows your heart. I don't know all of you. I just pray that you will not allow yet another Christmas season to pass you by without thinking on, considering these promises for yourself. And I can assure you that as Jesus promised his disciples, therein is a peace that will endure, and it will just embrace you in such a way that will give you a hope and a joy and a confidence, not in yourself, but in himself, in Jesus, the one who is our peace. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, we just thank you.